Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here for today's press conference. I am joined today by our Health Commissioner, Dr. Dzirasa, John Brett, Executive Director of Emergency Management for UMD, our Police Commissioner, Michael Harrison, Dr. Lisa Margakis, Dr. Joshua Sharfstein, and Dr. David Marcosi of Johns Hopkins. I want to begin by discussing where Baltimore City currently stands after the governor's announcement earlier this week. On Wednesday, Governor Hogan made an announcement to lift many of the state's COVID-19 mandates. I have an obligation to protect the public health and safety of Baltimoreans, and I plan to keep that at the forefront of everything I do. Since the onset of this pandemic, Baltimore has leaned on expert direction of healthcare professionals, as well as local data on COVID-19, hospitalizations, deaths, and new cases to shape our reopening efforts. We update our executive orders based on the latest trends and these reopening indicators, which you can always find at coronavirus.baltimorecity.gov. Our approach will not change. Baltimore will stay the course. Under the executive order released by my office today, Baltimore's existing local COVID-19 mandates will remain in place. You can see that order and all past executive orders online at baltimorecity.gov and simply click on mayoral executive orders. As President Biden stated in his primetime address last night, this fight is far from over. Our nation and our city are still very much in the midst of this pandemic. From January 1, 2021 through this very moment, there have been 9,371 COVID-19 cases and 172 deaths among Baltimore City residents. That is 172 of our neighbors, friends, and family members taken from us from COVID in this calendar year. We cannot express this enough that we must remain vigilant every day, every hour, in everything that we do. Now is not the time to let up. On the eve of St. Patrick's Day, I'm calling on residents to consider the safety of your neighbors and loved ones. We have consistently seen spikes in COVID-19 cases following holidays where people get together. I know the weather is nice and we are all anxious to be together and to be out, but the pandemic isn't over. Don't let the thrill of a good time harm your health or the health of someone you care about. Please avoid large gatherings, practice physical distance, and continue to wear a mask. Better said, be responsible. Think about tomorrow, think about next month, think about the rest of the year and the rest of your life that you want to have. It's not the time to go bar hopping. It's not the time to be reckless with your personal activity just because the weather is better in the St. Patrick's Day weekend. We know that can lead to the lives of people dying. You can literally kill someone that you love by being irresponsible. And now I'm going to turn it over to our health commissioner, Dr. Dzirasa, to give us an update on our most recent data. Dr. Dzirasa.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mayor Scott, for your leadership during this pandemic, and thank you to our partners joining us today. I'd like to briefly share the data on key COVID-19 metrics in Baltimore City. As of this morning, we have lost 811 lives to COVID-19. We have had a total of 41,395 cases in Baltimore City residents, and our latest 7-day average new case count is 93 cases per day, a 12% decrease from 4 weeks ago, but a slight increase from last week's average of 92 cases per day. Our latest 7-day positivity is 2.2%, a decrease of 24% from 4 weeks ago, but a slight increase from 2% positivity last week. Our hospital utilization rates have slightly increased, with intensive care units at 84% and acute care units at 88% capacity. Fatalities due to COVID-19 are now averaging at about one death per day, a 53% decrease from 4 weeks ago. As of this morning, the Baltimore City Health Department and our healthcare partners have reached 15.3% of the city's population with at least the first dose of the vaccine, which in total is 90,978 Baltimore City residents. 51,569 residents have also received their second dose. As always, all of this information can be found on our public dashboards at coronavirus.baltimorecity.gov. To summarize, what we're seeing right now could be described as a plateau or flat line of our case data. We made significant improvements from our case counts, fatalities, and hospitalizations compared to where we were in December. However, we've seen some fluctuations in the data just this week. And after a year of witnessing ups and downs in data trends, we remain consistent in our certainty that time is needed to determine the true direction of these trends. As we have consistently stated throughout the pandemic, our strong preference is to have at least 4 weeks of data before implementing new restrictions or removing old ones. And we will be on track to seeing where things stand by early next week, as March 22nd marks 4 weeks since we implemented the latest changes to phase one restrictions. The majority of vaccinations provided in the city so far have been Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. As a reminder, these are both two-dose vaccines, with the second dose of Pfizer being administered at least 21 days after the first dose, and the second dose of Moderna being given at least 28 days after the first dose. CDC guidance states that you can wait up to 6 weeks or 42 days between doses. However, we strongly encourage residents to stay within that 3 to 4 week period as much as possible. We're pleased to report that according to ImmuNet data, of those city residents eligible for their second dose, 91% of residents total and 88% of our residents over the age of 65 have received their second dose. However, in reviewing the data, approximately 2% of city residents that have been vaccinated, almost 1,800 individuals, have not been documented as receiving their second dose yet, more than 6 weeks after receiving their first dose of the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. This is a concern because unlike the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, both doses of Pfizer and Moderna vaccines must be given for the vaccine to be fully effective. Please, if you have received your first doses of either Pfizer or Moderna, make sure you have your plan to get your second shot. We know that 44% of those who have not received their second dose after more than 6 weeks are adults over the age of 60, and we encourage everyone to check on your older relatives who have been vaccinated to ensure that they have a plan to get their second dose. In order to ensure equitable and rapid vaccination of city residents, the health department is continuing to work with healthcare partners to direct doses to older adults, city educators, first responders, and people experiencing homelessness. Beginning next week, we will also be supporting continuity of government operations. Next week, we will be utilizing our doses in the following manner. 750 doses will be reserved for Baltimore City residents over 65 years old, city educators, and individuals supporting continuity of government operations at our closed PAS site at the Baltimore City Community College. 1,150 doses will be reserved for clinical partners operating closed pod sites serving Baltimore City older adults from our Maryland Access Point list, as well as city educators. This allotment includes supporting the vaccinations at a new vaccine clinic in partnership with the University of Maryland, Baltimore. We are pleased to have UMB as a new partner, and John Bratt, the Executive Director of Emergency Management for UMB, will be joining us shortly to share a few words about this new option for vaccinations here in the city. 1,000 doses will be reserved for our mobile vaccination clinics, serving older adults living in senior housing sites and individuals experiencing homelessness living in congregate living settings. The health department is continuing to scale up its successful mobile vaccination clinics alongside our healthcare partners, using the city's allocations of doses to bring vaccines directly to our older adults living in senior housing buildings and residents living in temporary housing. This week, we are pleased to report that we have held 20 mobile clinics to date and provided 2,000 first doses of vaccines directly to city residents through our mobile testing teams. We are grateful for our partners at MedStar Health, Johns Hopkins Health System, Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, LifeBridge Health, and Safeway, who have all played a vital role in reaching the city's older adults and housing insecure residents where they are as a part of our mobile vaccine clinic program. The number of mobile clinics we can host is dependent on our weekly vaccine supply. And next week, working with our partners, we will be visiting the Hollins House, Rosemont Towers, Apostolic Towers, St. Mary's Roland View 2, and Renaissance Garden Apartments for first dose clinics. We will also be returning to Harlem Garden Senior Apartments and the Morrell Park Apartments for second dose clinics. Additionally, through partnerships with the Lord Baltimore Hotel, we will be hosting vaccination events for those living in temporary housing at the Recovery Center of Maryland, McVett, and Pender Hughes Shelter, as well as a second dose clinic in partnership with Healthcare for the Homeless at the Weinberg Housing Resource Center. Testing for COVID-19 remains a vital component of the overall pandemic response, and we still encourage residents to get tested if they're experiencing symptoms suggestive of COVID-19 or have been in close contact with someone experiencing symptoms of COVID-19. Our mobile testing clinic schedule is posted weekly on our social media accounts and on our website, coronavirus.baltimorecity.gov/testing. Additionally, please remember to pick up the phone when MD COVID calls, as our contact tracing program remains as vital as ever to quickly identify and reduce disease transmission. As always, please continue to wash your hands, wear your mask over your nose and mouth, and reduce your contact with others to slow the spread of disease. Baltimore has weathered this pandemic and has remained relatively safe because our residents understand the nature of this disease. We wear masks, we keep our distance, and we are getting vaccinated. Now is not the weekend to throw away a year's worth of best practices. While we all miss our friends, our families, and parties, this year's St. Patrick's Day celebration should be held at home or in small groups to reduce the chances of disease transmission, reduce the burden on our hospital system, and to save lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dzirasa, and the entire team at the Baltimore City Health Department for your life-saving and many times thankless work over this last year. I want to now recognize John Bratt, Executive Director of Emergency Management for UMD, to say a few words about our new partnership. Mr. Bratt.
Thank you, Mayor Scott. Since the beginning of the pandemic, UMB has strived to meet its mission of improving the human condition and serving the citizens of Baltimore. As an anchor institution, we could not think of a better use of our talent and resources than to build vaccine administration capacity right here in our backyard. I'd like to take a moment to thank our partners for making this effort possible, including the City of Baltimore Health Department, the Maryland Department of Health, and the University of Maryland Medical System. And of course, the faculty, students, and staff of the University of Baltimore, of University of Maryland Baltimore, who have served countless nights, days, and weekends to make this effort possible. I'd like to also thank this, we are excited about our continued partnership with the City of Baltimore and look forward to administering vaccine to those who need it most in the city and look forward to meeting that need. Thank you again, Mayor Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Bratt. As we have done throughout the pandemic, Baltimore will continue to evaluate the data on a regular basis to determine the path forward. Next week will be our fourth week of our current mandates. The Health Commission and I will provide an update next week regarding our plans moving forward, sticking to our original plan and course. Now, before we switch gears, I want to give the most important voice in our pandemic, our doctors and public health professionals, an opportunity to say a few words about our continued COVID efforts, if they would like, Dr. Shawspin and Dr. Margakis.
Thank you so much, Mayor Scott. Thank you so much, Dr. Dzirasa. It's great to be here. I'm Josh Sharfstein from Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. You know, when this pandemic started, people had in mind the places that would probably be hit the hardest in the United States. And we saw cities and regions kind of move into the forefront, be the headline cities of where there was just a tremendous amount of COVID. And if you look back on the last year, Baltimore has vastly exceeded expectations. There were many reasons why people thought that Baltimore would be one of those cities that was just disproportionately devastated by COVID, and it has not been one of those cities. And you think back for this year, why is that the case? And a major reason are the two people who are behind me, Mayor Scott and Dr. Dzirasa. The city worked collaboratively with the University of Maryland and Johns Hopkins right away to set up a call center, to set up safe housing for people, to provide testing, to provide mobile testing. And that spirit has carried through a number of announcements and policies based on evidence, the tremendous dashboard that you've seen. And I just think it's important to take a little bit of the broader picture and realize that Baltimore has gotten to this point as a city with great leadership, great partnership, and great response by the citizens of Baltimore. And personally, I want to thank Dr. Dzirasa particularly for her just tremendously steadfast leadership in this incredibly challenging situation, just, you know, extraordinary moment in time. And the way that Baltimore has managed this is, if you take an analogy of a boat moving towards safer waters, the city has had its hand on the tiller. And it has been steering the ship based on the best data available to get to a better place. And this is not the time to take your hand off the tiller. This is not the time to completely, and I like the translation of that too. This is not the time to act as if that COVID is no longer a challenge. It is a deadly challenge, and it is exactly by thinking methodically, basing on data, and talking optimistically about the fact that we are headed towards a much better tomorrow if we can stick together today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I would like to add my thanks to Dr. Dzirasa and to Mayor Scott for their leadership and for keeping the city safe through this extraordinarily challenging time. I think that I would just echo the words of hope that you've heard here today. We see vaccinations advancing quite rapidly, and Johns Hopkins is very pleased to be a partner in the public-private partnership in order to serve the community and to vaccinate our residents and keep everyone safe. I would just, as an infection prevention professional, add a note of support for all of the infection prevention measures that we are now all so familiar with: masking, physical distancing, and avoiding indoor gatherings, particularly large gatherings. And to say that these have worked. They have worked to keep our city safe. And in addition to the SARS-CoV-2 virus, we have seen great success in almost elimination of influenza this year. So let's persevere as the weather warms and some of the holidays and spring breaks come. Please keep going and hold on for a little bit longer while vaccinations roll out and we can see brighter days ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you all for being here and for your great work. We have all had to make major adjustments to our lives during this pandemic, but I want everyone to know that I greatly appreciate every resident, healthcare worker, frontline employee, teacher, and everyone who has gone above and beyond to show and do their part in slowing COVID-19. Your efforts have kept our city going through these unprecedented times. Although the latest trends in public health data are promising and more people continue to get vaccinated, Baltimore is not in the clear yet. Our country and our world is not in the clear yet. We must stay the course and make responsible decisions on behalf of ourselves and those around us.